आता गेली.
So good afternoon to all of you. Once again, I welcome you in this online session of our pre-PhD coursework lecture on one of the chemical technique, Auger electron spectroscopy. This spectroscopy is the fundamental understanding of atomic spectroscopy where we consider our element in the isolated atom form. Also we consider the electrons revolving around the nucleus in the various cells as opposite to that visualized by quantum mechanical rules. So cell occurrence of cell model, existence of cell model is the basic building block of Auger electron spectroscopy. Basically, this is three electron process where atom becomes doubly ionized, and during this process, electrons which carry the characteristic energy, depending on the binding energy. If we measure and analyze the electrons which are emitted by the material, and take the spectrum. Spectrum is number of electrons, number on y-axis and on x-axis energy. So if we analyze the electrons which are emitted in this process with the help of say cylindrical mirror analyzer or hemispherical mirror analyzer or any kind of energy analyzer, and further if they are detected, then we get lot of information, very important crucial information about the chemical analysis. So let me begin my lecture. This table shows analytical techniques, a list of the techniques, analytical techniques employed in the thin film science and technology. Of course, most of the techniques they are applied to the bulk materials also, but here, as my course was intended to teach the students of solid state physics, the thin film preparation, characterization, growth and properties and the characterization tools, therefore here I have listed the techniques for analysis of the thin film materials. So we illuminate subject a thin film material by a kind of beam. Maybe it may be electron beam, maybe ion beam, or the electromagnetic radiation. Having those particular energies lie between keV or electron volt to million electron volt. Depending on the interaction between the electron or the ion or the photon with the material of the thin film, we get secondary signal in the form of maybe electron, electromagnetic radiation, or the secondary ion, or the backscattered electron, or the electromagnetic radiation. The various analytical techniques are defined. And from these techniques, we get different information about the surface topography, chemical composition, or the chemical environment, depth, trace element analysis, crystal structure, and whatnot. So these are the list of the techniques we will going to cover in this lecture. The electron primary beam having energy of a few electron volt to 10 kilo electron volt or 30 kilo electron volt, when it is subjected to the material in thin film form, then we get the secondary signal in the form of electrons, and that technique is called as Auger electron spectroscopy. I am going to tell you why it is called as Auger electron spectroscopy, and this technique is used for analysis of surface composition. I have got another table where I have listed few techniques among the others from the previous table, and this is the list of the technique for chemical characterization, and these are KIDAX, EAS, XPS, RBS, and SIMS. In my previous lecture, we have seen in detail the KIDAX analysis, energy dispersion analysis for chemical composition, and we know we can analyze the samples, elements from Z is equal to 11, that is sodium, up to uranium. With the, if you want to analyze the elements below sodium, that is hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, etc., etc., up to neon, then the techniques like AES, XPS, RBS, SIMS are useful. As far as AES is concerned, we can analyze the elements between lithium to uranium. Detection limit is very nice, 0.1 atomic percent. Lateral resolution also is 50 nanometer or so, and probe length, probe depth is 15 angstrom. We can go beyond also by removing layer by layer depth profiling analysis. Somebody will ask, why not, sir, hydrogen and helium? Hydrogen and helium, you start with lithium. So I am going to tell you the answer of this question. The answer is, OJ electron spectroscopy requires minimum 3 electrons for the emission of electrons. So in the nucleus of hydrogen, there is only 1 electron in the outermost orbit. In helium, there are 2. In lithium, there are 3. Therefore, we can begin with lithium. Somebody will say, then why up to you? Why not? There are the elements where the atomic number is up to 120 or even greater than that, people are investigating. Unfortunately, the lifetime of these elements after uranium is less. We know the elements after uranium, they are unstable and they are radioactive. They are continuously emitting alpha, beta, gamma kind of radiations, and they are decomposing themselves in the disintegrated form in their isotopes. And therefore, it is very difficult to analyze them with the help of these chemical techniques. Therefore, the upper limit of all chemical techniques is uranium. Keep in mind this fact. Unstable, radioactive. So, we can play within H2U. So far as chemical analysis is concerned. So with the help of AES, we can analyze the elements between lithium to uranium. This figure shows, for understanding the working of AES, once again we need to discuss electron-matter interaction, where the teardrop type of interaction volume is shown, and where the primary electron, it interacts with matter, maybe thin film having thickness of the order of 1 micron or so, and various signals like secondary electron, backscattered electron, continuous X-ray, characteristic X-ray, cathodoluminescence, fluorescence, transmitted electrons, diffracted electrons, scattered electrons, and Auger electrons, they are emitted. So these Auger electrons, they are emitted within the length 10 nanometer, that is 100 angstrom. So analysis depth is up to 10 nanometer or 100 angstrom. For this, I have used this book, OJ electron spectroscopy or Auger electron spectroscopy by Gunavardhane and Aruma Niyagam. And you can get PDF file of this on the internet easily. This Auger electrons, they are also pronounced as Auger electrons in German. In this, A and R is silent. Therefore, Auger or OJ. So I personally pronounce it as OJ electrons. So Auger electrons are also called as OZ electrodes. What are various advantages of this technique? Certainly, this technique is not destructive technique. We need to just keep the sample, illuminate it by the electrons, having energy few keV, and collect the OZ electron signal, and you can reuse your sample. So, in that sense, it is non-destructive. We can do elemental composition analysis. We can tell which elements, chemical elements are present in the sample and what is their percentage, that we can do. This is a highly surface sensitive technique. Therefore, we cannot go in the bulk. You cannot go beyond 10 nanometer. Detection limit also is very, very low. Also, one of the disadvantages of the redox technique was in a certain region of the energy, few peaks of 4 to 5 elements, they were overlapping. And this redox technique is not able to distinguish between the presence of various elements where peak positions lie very near to each other. But with the help of AES technique, it is possible to distinguish between two closely spaced elements. This is of course very much reliable and reproducible, and it has great spatial resolution. We can do depth profiling, we can do mapping, and many more things we can do with the help of this OZ electron spectroscopy. Let me share with you some historical happenings as far as the AES technique is concerned, and the scientists behind this technique. In 1923, scientist Peary Auger, he reported for the first time Auger effect. This is photograph of Peary Auger, and he, in his paper, which was published in 1925 in Journal of Physical Radium, he reported the Auger effect. What is Auger effect? I am going to explain you in next couple of slides. In 1953, after 26 to 27 years, Lander, he for the first time applied this Auger effect or OZ effect for the solids. So, he illuminated solid and recorded the OZ electrons which are coming from the solids. And there we get the OZ spectrum. OZ spectrum is the graph of intensity versus energy. So, it was observed that this signal was very weak. OZ signal was very weak and the peaks were buried in the noise. So, it was very difficult to distinguish between noise and the signal. Therefore, in 1968, Harris, he for the first time utilized the derivative of the signal, derivative number of change in number per unit energy, dN by dE. So, derivative, he for the first time implemented in the OZ spectra to clearly identify the difference between the noise and signal. And the peak intensity was pronounced and peak position was very much precisely determined. So, therefore, in 1968, utility of derivative in EES was employed by Harris. In 1969, he used cylindrical mirror analyzer in OZ electrons. So, prior to cylindrical mirror analyzer, it was energy, I am going to tell you the name. So, it was not that much effective technique for taking the OZ spectra. So, Palmberg, he for the first time used cylindrical mirror analyzer in the OZ analysis. And in the same year, commercial OZ electron spectrometer was developed. Now, in 1971, the simultaneous scanning and OJ and XPS multi-electron technique was developed by McDonald and Waldron. It is called as a scanning Auger microscopy. So scanning Auger microscopy will give you the scanning electron microscopy images, then it will give you OJ signal, it will give you mapping of the elements. It can, with the help of this technique, you can do the depth profiling, so all in one. So that is called as scanning Auger microscope. And in 1972, this scanning Auger microscopy was for the first time demonstrated once again by Palmer. Unfortunately, this is so fundamental research and invention by P. Auger. For this result, for this invention, Nobel Prize in Physics or in Chemistry was not awarded. So let us begin our discussion about the OJ effect or Auger effect. For observing Auger electrons, for creating Auger electrons, you need ultra high vacuum. Vacuum of the order of 10 to the power of minus tor, minus 9 tor is necessary. And why this much vacuum is necessary? This much vacuum is necessary to have uninterrupted electron passage and to avoid the contamination. I am going to tell you the way in which contamination occurs in AES. And this AES or OJ electron energy, it is between say 100 electron volt to 800 electron volt, and therefore you don't want to scatter your electrons and you need the actual signal, and therefore ultra high vacuum is needed. As I told, it is a 3 electron process. So when high energy electrons from the thermionic or field emission gun having energy say 100 keV or so, or 50 keV appropriate energy, they come and collide with the matter, then this energy is sufficiently high. It is so high that it knocks out the innermost electron or the electron from the core levels, maybe electron from K cell, L cell, M cell, etc. Innermost, inner core levels, not valence levels, because the energy of the valence level is less as compared to 100 keV. So when it knocks out electron from the innermost orbit, say K electron, then this atom becomes singly ionized. Means one electron is less, therefore the atom becomes plus charge. It becomes ion. But this atom, it becomes now unstable. Therefore, this vacancy is filled by other electron. Maybe in this case, I have showed the electron from L1 cell. It fills the vacancy. Still, atom is singly ionized. Keep in mind, one electron is less. But this if it is ready to transition, then X-rays are generated. We have seen in XPS and in the production of X-ray. If this is radioactive transition, then the X-rays are generated. But generally, it is not non-radioactive transition. And in the, it is non-radioactive transition means electron goes from L1 to K. But energy is still there. And that energy is being picked up by the electron in the outer shell. And that electron is isolated from the element. And therefore, this energy is responsible to knock out the electron from other cell or maybe this cell, depending on from which cell, subcell, electron has gone out, then the nomenclature changes. So basically, one electron has left initially and second electron also has left. So this is the doubly ionized atom. So in this electron matter interaction, atom initially becomes singly ionized, then either X-rays are generated or the OJ electrons are generated. Hope you have understood this 3 electron process. So what are energy state notations? We have seen in X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, we use X-ray notation depending on in which state electron is. And why these X-ray notations and the Auger notations are necessary, I want to tell you. You see, in this previous figure, I consider the knocking out of this electron from the innermost shell by supposing the fact that other electrons are not present, or the presence of other electron doesn't affect the ejection of this electron. So, if when I want to have the want to find the energy of the OJ electron, I need to have energy of this K shell electron, L shell electron, and this L shell electron, and effectively then I can find the kinetic energy. But for that, I need the energy of these particular orbit in the neutral state, and energy of these states can be calculated by supposing that electron revolving in that orbit. By supposing one electron rotating in K shell, one electron in N1 shell, etc., etc., etc. So basically, we consider the atom to be one electron type of atom, and therefore the X-ray spectra is a kind of alkali spectra. So alkali spectra is a doublet spectra. Those who have, of course, you are MSc physics student, therefore in atomic spectroscopy you have already studied two valence electron spectroscopy, and all the rules of two valence electron spectroscopy, they are applied here. The cells K, L, M are designated based upon the principal quantum number N. We know N is equal to 1, 2, 3, etc., etc. Based upon the azimuthal quantum number L, and this comes into picture due to orbital motion of the electron around the nucleus. And in addition to this orbital motion, we have spinning motion of the electron around the nucleus. And these both motion, orbital motion and spin motion, they are coupled to each other. And that therefore, this coupling motion, electron motion around the nucleus, spinning motion and orbital motion, gives rise to effective state of the atom. And that effective state is represented by the effective resultant vector, called as resultant orbital momentum vector or resultant vector. And this is resultant of orbital motion vector and spin motion vector. So depending on the angle between L and S, the energy states are splitted into doublets. Therefore, J comes into picture. One also should remember the fact that the origin of these quantum numbers is the consequence of the quantization. What after all this quantization is? Quantization means only few amongst many. For example, in this case, just now I told, the angle between L and S vectors, when they are precessing around each other, of course this is hypothetical picture of precession of vectors around each other. So the angle between L and S can be from 0 to 180, is it not, or 160. But out of all possible angles, only few angles between L and S, they are permitted, and that those angles you can find out. And this is called as quantization. And this comes in the solution of the Schrodinger equation. And therefore, for the electrons evolving in 1s orbit, we define quantum numbers to be L is equal to 0, S is equal to half, J is equal to half. In P orbit, L is equal to 0, then S is equal to half, J is equal to 3 by 2 and a half. And we go ahead 3 by 2 and 5 by 2, 5 by 2 and 7 by 2, etc., etc. So for all permutations and combinations, for depending on N, L value takes all possible values between 0 to N minus 1, that also we know. So J values can be calculated, and you give the term symbol like this 2s plus 1 Lj. And correspondingly, if the electron, this electron is in say 1s shell, then it is called as a K in the Auger notation. The state is denoted by K. Then L1, L2, L3, M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, N1, N2, N3, etc., etc. And these are the X-ray notations. Now we will not think of these X-ray notations in XPS. X-ray notations are. But keep in mind, in modern technique, both XPS and OJ electron spectroscopy, both are coupled in the same unit. Therefore, the X-ray notation and OJ notation, corresponding OJ notations, they are useful. So, in case of sodium, we know where the electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. So, this 3s electron is responsible, or the 2p electron is responsible for splitting the orbits into doublet p3 by 2 and doublet p half. And the distance between these two states is, the splitting is of the order of 4.5 into 10 to the power minus 5 electron volt. This also we account in the XPS, keep in mind. And this distance also. Anyway, so the energy states in OJ, they are K, L1, L2, L3, M2, depending on which electron it is. And the same I have shown here in the bifurcated way, in the categorized way. For example, this is the vacuum level, and the above electron become free. And here, these are the bound electron levels. And as you go towards core from the valence shell, the binding energy increases. And we know for the 1s electron, in case of hydrogen, the binding energy is minus 13.6 electron volt, that we know. And as you go here and here, 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 the energy decreases. So here, the 1s, 2s, 3s, etc., etc., all the levels and their corresponding OZ notations, K, L1, L2, L3, M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, N1, N2, N3, N4, N5, etc., etc. I have showed. So what we see, the distance between K and L1, K and L2, and K and L3, and of course, these level up to N is equal to 3, it is more. But this distance is very, very small. So, it is possible to nomenclature or give the names to various energy states. So, let us take a simple example of KL2L3 Auger transition. KL2L3 is the nomenclature of one of the OJ transition, where the K, first letter K, stands for the ionization, singly ionized atom. So, the incident electron, it removes the innermost electron from the K shell, therefore this K. Now, this vacancy, if it is filled by the L2 electron, then the letter L2 comes. And this energy, internal transition, if it knocks out the electron from the L3, say, then it is denoted as L3. So, effectively, it is KL2L3, KL2L3 Auger transition. For example, this KLL Auger transition can be shown on in the various ways. For example, this is KL2L3. Means KL2L3. This is where the atom is doubly ionized. In the P cell, two less electrons are there. And therefore, the effective number of electrons are 6. 4 plus 2, 6. 5 plus 1, 6. 6 plus 0, 6. So, depending on from which cell electrons have left, then the Auger transition is denoted KL1L1, both electrons from the one K electron is 1s, and both electrons from 2s they are utilized. Therefore, KL1L1. Similarly, KL1L2, KL1L3, KL2L2, KL2L3, etc., etc., etc. Just for sake of understanding, I am taking your little more time just to explain you and make you realize, make you think on the thing which are displayed on the slides. So, slowly I am taking my time. Let us categorize various auger processes. How various auger processes they are designated. For example, KL1, L2, just now I explained. K electron is removed, L1 vacancy is filled, and L2 OJ electron. L1 M1 M1 also is possible. So electron not from K cell but from L1 cell is removed, and vacancy is filled by M1 electron, and the other electron from M1 is removed. So L1 M1 M1. This is called as ABB type of transition. ABB type of transition, ABB type of, and these are stronger auger transitions, and they are KLL or LMM. Just now I said LMM transition. If it is AAB type of transition, AAB means electron from L1 is removed for singly ionized case, and valence vacancy is filled by other L1 electron. So L1 L2 and OJ electron from M1. So this is called as Coaster cloning type of transition, and these are very strong transitions. If the valence electrons they are involved in the auger electron, for example KLV means electron from the K cell is removed, where this is filled by L electron, and OJ electron from the valence cell is removed, then the V letter comes. So we use V letter wherever valence. So depending on which electron is involved, the nomenclature depends. We know in the OJ electrons, when you illuminate a material surface with the help of electrons having particular energy, then the OJ electrons are emitted. And these OJ electrons, they have their energy. I have showed in maybe Dux technique or maybe in SEM technique, the energy spectrum where first was secondary electron, then OJ electron, then low level energy electron, and these are the backscattered electron, then plasmons were there. So location of OJ electrons is after secondary electron. Their energy lie between some 100 electron volt or so. Few hundred electron volt also. So when these OJ electrons are emitted in the instrumentation, aim is to measure the kinetic energy of these OJ electrons. So when we say kinetic energy, ultimately the kinetic energy is related to the binding energy. And we have seen in the previous lecture, in XPS lecture, the way in which kinetic energy and binding energy was related. It was related by kinetic energy is equal to H nu minus binding energy minus spectrometer wave function, that we know. Here, the exciting agency is not photon. There it was X-rays. Here it is not photon. Here it is other electron. Therefore, for H nu, we have something else. What is that? Let us discuss. So, OJ electron involves measurement of a kinetic energy of the OJ electrons, and this kinetic energy is a characteristic of the element, and this is independent of the primary beam energy. Whether you use 100 keV electron or 200 keV electron, this kinetic energy of that OJ electron will not change, and therefore this technique depends only on the atomic energy levels of the host elements or the matter which is under investigation. Therefore, this technique is very, very much useful, and it is a characteristic of element. We know how we define the kinetic energy in this OJ electron case. For example, the kinetic energy is the last energy, means the energy with which electron moves, it leaves the atom. And this energy would be the energy difference between the singly ionized electron and doubly ionized electron energy states. Because earlier electron is singly ionized, and then OJ electron is produced by doubly ionized, and therefore kinetic energy would be difference between doubly ionized final state and singly ionized initial state. Let us suppose that A, B, C are the three energy states involved in the OJ transition. A is the state innermost B is the single ionized and C is the OJ electron state, for example, and their corresponding energies are EA, EB and EC. Then ultimately EB minus EC, EA minus EB minus EC would be the kinetic energy, because we need to take into account the energy of this K shell also. Now, you see the difference between the energy for kinetic energy in this case and in XPS case is that it is the difference between H nu minus binding energy there, and here it is the difference between EA minus binding energy. And of course, if there is a spectroscopic work function phi, is the amount of energy to take the electron from the Fermi energy level to the vacuum level to make the electron free. So our system is in the spectrometer, therefore the spectrometer also should have its own energy for leaving the electron. Therefore, if we insert that also, then the effective equation becomes E is equal to EA minus EB minus EC minus phi A. For example, in case of OKLL, Auger process, the innermost electron, K shell electron goes, vacancy is filled by L shell and the OJ electron from other L shell is removed. Then, how the kinetic energy of the OJ electron is formed? It is formed by taking binding energy of the K, means energy, this energy. It is 532 electron volt, and I am going to show you in tables and how this energy can be calculated. And the energy of this L cell and energy of this L cell is 8 electron volt, and spectrometer work function is 4 electron volt. Then 816 minus 20, 532 minus 20 is 512. So you see that in case of oxygen, I am going to show you the peak occurs around 504, 510 or so electron volt. So depending on energy, we can tell which element is present and what kind of OJ transition has taken place. So let us discuss the instrumentation of this OJ electron spectroscopy, and on this slide I have showed schematic representation of OJ electron spectroscopy instrument, and it has five main components. First one is the electron source, electron gun, is the same gun which we use in the scanning electron microscopy in energy dispersion analysis by X-ray, is the electron gun. It can be the thermionic electron gun, or it can be field emission gun, Schottky emission gun. Generally, field emission gun is preferably used, but it adds to the cost of the instrument, therefore they use thermionic emission gun to reduce the cost of the instrument. So electron source, ion sputter ion optical column is the another important block. And why this is used? This is used because this technique is very much surface sensitive, and we need, in case of AES, we need very flat surface, and therefore your surface is rough, for example, then with the help of the sputter ion etching, you make the surface optically flat. This is one. Other thing, because if we expose this sample, there are chances of oxidation or occurrence of impurities inclusion in the surface. Therefore, if we sputter remove these ions, so for that the sputter ion gun is necessary. Secondary electron analyzer, and this is cylindrical mirror analyzer type of analyzer, which is the heart of the technology. And I am going to explain you one of the analyzers, spherical analyzer, I am going to explain in this lecture. Then secondary ion detector, it can be the scintillation counter, and then followed by a photomultiplier tube, and this is connected via electronic circuitry to the CRT. So secondary electron detector and then computer control is necessary. As I told, in this technique, the important thing is we need ultra high vacuum. In XPS also we need ultra high vacuum. In AES also we need ultra high vacuum. And ultra high vacuum of the order of 10 to the power of minus tau or even below is necessary. For what? For uninterrupted passage of the electron beam and to avoid the contamination of the surface by atomic gases. And these electrons, they are scattered by the molecules in the gas phases. Even we take, say, 10 to the power of minus 9 torr pressure, even though there are gas molecules there, but the number of collisions or mean free path is more. So here in this small figure, I have tried to show, demonstrate in front of you, how the expression for mean free path. Mean free path is the average distance between two successive collisions. And this is a collision of the two electrons, electrons which are OJ electrons which are emitted. And these electrons, they collide with the gaseous atoms, molecules inside the chamber. So if for development of the theoretical formula, say by the beam of the electrons, it is spherically cylindrical, having area pi d square, d is the radius, volume will be pi d square vt, and vt is the length, for example. Then we can find the volume. Volume is this much. And if in this volume, if we multiply this volume by density, density is number per unit volume, into volume will give you number. And for that number, if we divide by the distance, for example, then we will get the mean free path. So mean free path lambda is equal to, of course this is the formula, I have already taught this to solid state physics students, and I can explain to you also how this formula comes. Lambda is equal to 1 upon root pi, root 2 pi d square into rho. Rho is the density. Density is equal to n upon v. N upon v, from this relation formed from the ideal gas, equation of state of the ideal gas, n upon v is equal to p by kt. So if I put p by kt there, then lambda is equal to kt root 2 pi d square p. So ultimately, for given diameter at room temperature, for example, and if we put k, the Boltzmann constant, then we see that mean free path is inversely proportional to the pressure. So if we decrease pressure, mean free path will increase. That is the simple logic. Also, the gas density, density rho is equal to p by kt. So if pressure is low, density is low. That's what it means. And if we decrease pressure, the gas density also will decrease. So here, based upon this formula, some calculation I have shown. For the atmospheric pressure, the gas density is of the order of 10 to the power of 25 molecules per meter cube, and mean free path is angstrom. Is it not? 10 to the power of minus 10 meter is angstrom. So it is 10 angstrom, 70 angstrom. And if we just decrease the pressure, if we decrease the pressure like this, so this is linear relation. It is not inverse. Lambda and p, they are, so if we decrease pressure, the mean free path increases. Mean free path increases. So you go, mean free path increases. And the mean free path in the given geometry of the AES or XPS, it should be more than, say, 50 meter or few centimeters, up to this much size. For example, it is 25 centimeter or so. So, and why this much path length, mean free path is necessary? When electron crosses this much distance, it will not collide with the other molecules. And therefore, the vacuum, ultra high vacuum, this is the range, low vacuum, medium vacuum, high vacuum, ultra high vacuum, very high vacuum and ultra high vacuum. In case of 10 to minus 9, for example, if you go like this, 10 to the power of 6 or 10 to the power of 5 meter, this much mean free path will be there. And so that we can maintain or keep safe the electron motion and its energy. Very importantly, its energy. Somehow we measure kinetic energy. Electron, if it collides with the gas molecules, it will lost its energy, and we cannot measure the actual energy of the electron. Therefore, ultra high vacuum is necessary. The electron optical column, where the electrons are emitted from the electron gun, maybe lab 6 or the field emission gun, depending on your requirement and depending on your budget, they use, generally they prefer field emission gun, but thermionic electron gun also is compatible. And I have already explained these things in my previous lecture, therefore it would be a repetition. A very fine tip of this field emission gun is responsible for producing 7 volt per centimeter field, and that field is sufficient to pull out the electron from the tip of the field emission gun or filament, and therefore it is possible to reduce the beam size, and that way it is possible to increase the resolution, and therefore beam divergence also is less. Therefore, field emission gun. In the ion optical column, as I told, this is particularly a sputtering unit, where ionization gases like argon or xenon, which don't interact because they are chemically inert gases, they are used, and heating arrangement, and when this gas is purged in the cylinder where electrons are generated and electrons are accelerated, then these ions, atoms converts into ions, and due to application of a bias, positive bias on the sample, the ions, they are attracted towards the sample and they etch the surface sample, and therefore this for depth profiling and sputter cleaning, the ion optical column is important. Electrons also are accelerated, and they ionize the atom, and these ionized atoms are useful in removing, cleaning or sputtering the sample surface. Various energy analyzer units or techniques, RFA, CMA and CHA, they are used in AES, because OJ spectroscopy is the measurement of kinetic energy of the emitted electron, and these various electron energy analyzers are used to measure the number of ejected electrons, N, as a function of energy to get a required spectrum. And most commonly used energy analyzers are RFA, retarding field analyzer, cylindrical mirror analyzer, CMA, and concentric hemispherical analyzer, CHA. In case of RFA, it has got limited energy resolution and poor signal to noise ratio, and they are used for low energy electron diffraction studies, and therefore this can't be used for the high energy diffraction or high energy analysis, and it is not an optimum choice, of course. But CME, where we use cylindrical mirrors. So we have two concentric cylinders, inner and outer cylinder, and these are biased. Outer cylinder is negatively biased and inner cylinder is relatively positively biased. And therefore, here emitted electrons, OJ electrons, when they are approaching towards the detector, they pass through a potential. And where there is a negative potential, electrons will be repelled, and where there is a positive potential, electrons will be attracted. So it is possible to choose the electrons having appropriate energy to fall on a detector, and this is the basic principle of CME. But in case of concentric hemispherical analyzer, you have the hemisphere having different radii. Of course, this is the band pass filter, and this also is a band pass. So both these CMA and CHA, they are due to their higher energy resolution and due to chemical state information, we can use. So hemispherical electron energy analyzer consists of two concentric hemispherical electrodes. This is inner and this is outer. And there is a provision to apply electrical voltage separately, V1 and V2, to these two hemispherical electrodes. Let us suppose R1 and R2 are the radii and V1 and V2 are the voltages. Then, based upon the theoretical analysis, we can have this relation. So, we can write the equation for EP, energy of the photoelectrons is equal to V divided by this. So, when you know R1, when you know R2, when you know V1 and V2, you know the energy. Or indirectly, if electrons having unknown energy, they are received at one particular radius, for example, this or that, and you know the potentials, then you can find the, you can trace out, you can collect the electrons at that particular radius. And therefore, electrons are linearly dispersed depending on their kinetic energy along the direction connecting the entrance and exit slit. And one detector at radius, say Rp, on the other side of the hemisphere will register only electrons of that single energy. And this is the basic principle of energy analyzer, hemispherical energy analyzer. And this radius will decide the energy and the intensity of these electrons at this channel, we can say, will decide the amount of radiation of that energy. So we can measure energy as well as intensity. What kind of spectrum we get? We get a general spectrum, direct spectrum like this. So we have a spectrum, electrons having energy 0 to 2 keV, for example. And I have already explained this graph in EDAX, where these are the electrons which are backscattered electrons, because the backscattered electrons are the primary electrons only, therefore their energy is same as that of the incident electrons. These are inelastically scattered electrons due to plasma oscillation, and these are secondary electrons having energy less than 50 electron volts. And OJ electrons are lie between, say, 200 electron volt to 800 to 900 electron. So this is the region where OJ electrons are. So we trim out the other portion of the spectrum and we take into account this spectrum. But here also, what you see in the direct spectrum, the peaks are not that much pronounced or visible. So Auger spectra, either it is a direct type or derivative type. Why it is necessary to take a derivative, I am explaining. So in the direct form, total electron concentration or signal as a function of kinetic energy of the electron is given. While in the derivative form, we take derivative of number of electrons of that energy with respect to energy, with respect to kinetic energy. So if I consider this portion, for example, then in the derivative form, you can see how peaks are pronounced, and you can see the peak position, and tip to tip distance will give you the peak intensity as well. So why to take derivative? The OJ peaks, their intensity is too small, and the noise background signal is very high compared to the signal, and therefore we run it the AES in the derivative mode to highlight the peaks and suppress the noise. So how it is done? The peak is modulated by the electron collection. We know this, after all, this number is proportional to the current effectively due to the electrons having that energy or the electrons. So we mix the other signal, modulating signal, AC signal, for example, in that the effective signal will be the combination of the signal and the modulating signal. And if you write for delta V to be this, say, for example, and Taylor series expansion, if we do, then this is the constant term and this is the time varying term. So if I take derivative of I, or indirectly n, ultimately I will get the contribution in the signal due to I dash. So apart from thinking on the mathematics involved in this, you keep in mind the fact that the different signal will give you the clear evidence, signature of the material. This is the OJ, direct OJ spectrum of FeCrNb alloy, and this is the differential form. Here you can see the peaks are there, but like differential signal, this is not that much clear. Here you see chromium, manganese, iron, how peaks they are distinctly seen. 571, 529, the importance of this derivative signal can be understood when you have corresponding direct signal with it. But keep in mind, the positions are so closely spaced, very near, 571, 636, 701. So these are differential Auger spectra of chromium, manganese and iron. As I told, in case of energy dispersion analysis by X-ray GDS, we cannot analyze the elements from sodium, below sodium, and we can analyze the elements from sodium to iron. But you see, this is the differential spectrum of the elements below sodium: fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen, carbon, boron, beryllium. And you see how pronounced peak these are. And therefore, Auger spectra in differential distribution characteristic of the lightest elements I have shown. And this is the advantage of the OJ over EDAX. Of course, OJ also has got disadvantage. It cannot analyze H and HE. But it can analyze other from the lithium onward. This is typical OJ graph of the methyl iodide, where you can see the peaks C1s, I4s, etc., etc. But the OJ transitions are denoted by M4 pi U, N23, or like these late numbers, 45, 25, 23. Very difficult to imagine where the position this would be, or what is the significance of this. This is not something different. They have avoided writing comma between this 4 and 5 in 45. What does this mean? M45 means M4 comma 5. Represents both M4 and M5 levels. When I say M45, both M4 and M5 are involved. So either it is M4 or it is M5. Either it is N3 or it is N3. So like that. So these are the positions. Just for sake of giving you more information about the peak identification and peak nomenclature I have created. So for example, here KL1 L2 3, how it reads? It reads like KL1 L2 and KL1 L3. I have showed in one of my earlier slide. So this example of oxygen, I have already explained you how to find the kinetic energy of the corresponding oxygen peak. So oxygen peak lie between 503 or so, and this oxygen binding unit, these tables, they are already there in standard literature. You can get these tables where the binding energy of the those electrons of those elements, for example, in this case, binding energy of chromium 1s, 2s, 2p, etc., etc., is given. And you get this formula EKL2L3, 532 minus 8 minus 8, and this is 4 and 512. So this is the way in which the computer program, it identifies the peak. And this graph I have already shown you in XPS also. This is the binding energy curve. Generally, this on the y-axis they plot Z in AES, and on x-axis they show binding energy, because the independent variable is on the x-axis, because what we get here is the energy. Therefore, it should be on x-axis. Therefore, we take a tangent and go to corresponding energy and correspondingly find the z, and correspondingly we find the energy. So this graph also is very important, and the computer software, it uses this graph. And what are the transitions? KLL up to z is equal to 20. From 20 to 40, for example, LMN, and above 40 up to 80, for example, MNN type of transitions are there, and above NOO type of transitions are there. And here correspondingly elements I have showed. For z is equal to 20 CA, z is equal to 40 ZR, ND 60, HG 80, etc. And in the literature, this such kind of tables are there. The corresponding kinetic energy is given. Therefore, we need not bother. But we need to do it manually once and then use the software program to find out the kinetic energy of given transition. This I was talking about. Our earlier graph was on the y-axis kinetic energy and on the x-axis atomic number, but just reverse the graph. So this is in terms of kinetic energy. And what we see KLL, LMM, MNN type of transitions, and these are NOO type of transitions. So for example, you get a peak at 1 keV, for example, 1000 electron volt. So you go, this is 1 keV, you go like this and you go there and you see energy, zinc must be present, or you go there, ND should be present, or you go there, and so on. So you don't get peak due to all elements, because only one element is present. Therefore, you get peak at that energy only. So you have possibilities with you, and you know what material it is there. What are applications of? Please allow me to take one phone call. Hello. माझं लेक्चर चालू आहे, जरा लेक्चर झाल्यानंतर फोन कराल का? अजून एक 15-20 मिनिटानंतर 4 पाठवून द्या. सो व्हॉट आर ॲप्लिकेशन्स ऑफ ओझे इलेक्ट्रॉन स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी? ॲज आय टोल्ड, इट इज यूज्ड फॉर क्वालिटेटिव्ह अनालिसिस. मीन्स क्वालिटेटिव्हली वन कॅन यूज दिस टेक्निक टू क्वालिटेटिव्ह नो विच इलेमेंट्स आर प्रेझेंट. We can quantitatively analyze how much percentage of that element is present in that. That for that also can be used. And for qualitatively, from 0 to 1000, Z lie between 3 to 14, KLL, 14 to 840, LMM, I told just now, 42 to 2, MNN, and above 82, NOO transitions are involved. And we can know the first step, survey spectrum. In short time, we get. We can do qualitative analysis to know the chemical composition and the in-depth distribution in the element. So how this can be done? We have peaks in two types, either in the differential form or in the original form. If it is in the original form, take peak area under curve. If it is in the derivative form, take peak to peak distance, this distance. And this peak to peak length is proportional to the chemical composition. At this peak area also is proportional to this chemical composition. So generally the peak area method is preferably used because it is more accurate, because it is a direct measurement. It is the manipulation. We do some procedure on this. We can know the chemical oxidation state upon peak positions and intensity and shapes. We can do depth profiling. I'm going to tell you how we do this. How this intensity peak area is proportional to the chemical composition, because the current, ultimately this intensity is proportional to current. The current is proportional to it. It is given by G times integration from 0 to infinity Ca e to the power of minus z by lambda cos theta dz, where Ca is the atomic concentration, dz is the thickness, z is the depth, theta is the emission angle, and lambda is the attenuation length. So ultimately, your intensity or the signal is proportional to chemical atomic concentration if your thickness, depth, emission angle and adhesion length are fixed. So ultimately you can know the chemical composition. To know the chemical environment of the element, whether your element it is in the metallic form or it is in the oxide matrix, the peak positions of the AES will change. So you see, orange is the Ti metal and blue one is the Ti in TiO2. So based upon the peak position and intensity, you can talk more about the chemical environment. So very similarly, we do this in the XPS also. For example, here I have tried to give you from one of the reference books, the energy level diagram of aluminium atom. These are isolated energy levels, and we know these are the discrete energy levels, K, L1, L2, L3, M, etc. When it becomes metal, we know the core level remains same, but the valence and conduction level gets converted into valence band and conduction band. And as this is metal, we know there is overlap between the valence band and conduction band, and the topmost field level is the Fermi level, that also we know. And therefore, the position of this L3, it changes. And when aluminium is in the alumina matrix, then again the peak position changes. So this position is different, and ultimately when aluminium or aluminium oxide or aluminium fluoride or aluminium nitride, the peak positions of the OG electrons, they are different, and it is possible to know the chemical environment. We can do quantitative compositional information as a function of depth of the surface. So this is a cross-sectional TEM of gold, TiN, hafnium zirconium oxide, HFZRO, TiN, titanium nitride, and SiO. So these are the elements of your thin film, for example. And these are the results published from, I have taken from Nanotechnology Journal. What you see, you have to remove these layers one by one. So it is destructive technique of measurement of the spectra, is it not? So you take a spectra of EAU when sputtering time is zero, for example. So you get peak due to AU or platinum if it is above, then the TiN, then HFZ, then TiN. So as you increase sputtering time, the number of layers will go away and you won't get signal due to AU, Ti, HZO when sputtering time is more. And at the end, you will get the signal due to Ti. So it is possible to map depth-wise the chemical composition with the help of AES, very similar to XPS. It is possible to map the elements in the AES. In EDAX also, we have seen the mapping. And here also, we can do the mapping. This is the scanning electron microscope image taken on the secondary electron mode. I have explained you various modes. So, secondary electron modes. And this is OG spectra of carbon. This bright spot are carbon. This middle one is aluminium. And whole outside is the silicon, and this is fluorine. So it is possible to do elemental mapping with the help of OG spectroscopy. This is the another example of elemental mapping, where this is ACM image. This is ACM image. A and B are the ACM image. This is low magnification image. This is a high magnification image. 10 kx. So we see here the hexagonal type of structure, and this grain is focused, and this grain is being analyzed by the help of AES, and it is found that there are two elements in SnSb superconducting multiwire, Sn and Nb. So AES picture for SN and NB. They are distinct, and we can see the distribution, the way in which SN and NB, they are distributed on the sample surface. So far as scanning auger microscopy is concerned, the same instrument contains gives SEM image, OJ spectra, and OJ map. So how this is done? So what you need secondary electron detector. In case of SEM, we know we have secondary electron detector or backscattered electron detector, depending on which mode you want. So this is SEM image. Sample current mode. This is SEM image on the secondary electron mode. I have explained to you sample current mode. I have explained to you secondary electron mode. And this is O mapping. This is silicon mapping. This is silicon mapping in non-oxide state. And this is aluminum mapping. So all these four are the OJ mapping. And therefore, this is called as scanning auger microscopy. We scan the electron over the sample surface, and you get corresponding with respect to position OJ signals. So I have come to the end of my presentation, where I will talk upon the limitations of the technique. Certainly, we cannot go in the bulk beyond 1 micrometer. We cannot go. Therefore, it is surface analytical technique, surface sensitive technique. Very high vacuum, ultra high vacuum is needed, therefore it will add to the cost of the instrument. Therefore XPS or AES, these are costly techniques. With the help of this technique, only solid specimens, particularly conducting and semiconducting samples, can be analyzed. For analysis of non-conducting samples, special procedures are to be employed. If the samples, they get decomposed due to electron bombardment radiation, because electrons are bombarded here for production of OJ electrons. If such samples are there, then this technique is not useful in that case. We need to do careful calibration, and it's very difficult to do this calibration. Quantification is very difficult, but with the help of advanced program and coupling techniques, means many techniques are, SIMS is there, XPS is there, AES is there, all these, if they are simultaneously presenting, then quantification can be done. H and HE cannot be detected. For detection of H and HE, you need to go for secondary ion mass, Rutherford Bach scattering, etc. In this case, intensity of the signal, it can be obscured by the secondary phenomena. So these are the few limitations of this technique, but the adapting or coping with these limitations, you can make use of this technique for fruitful purpose.